sod. Growing from the sod is grass. I know it looks a little silly, but the grass is very desired. It actually holds the roof together, and it keeps the roof watertight. Any water that it collects is stored within the sod, and that'll help keep our cabin extra cool in the summer and then extra warm in the winter. You will have a chance to go inside the cabin, and you'll notice all of the furniture is also made from resources found directly off the land. And if you go into any of the villages today, you'll see people still do live in cabins like this one. They will, of course, have a few modern conveniences. If they're lucky, they'll have electricity. If they're really lucky, they'll have running water. And if they're extremely lucky, they'll have internet. My grandpa actually became extremely lucky a couple of years ago. And this past winter, he discovered eBay. But this cabin here doesn't have any of those. Who wants to spend the next week in it? Okay, well, those few takers and myself are going to bunk it out in this nice, cool, spacious cabin. We'll let you folks do that little one over there to the left. That is a trapper's line cabin. Those would be placed along a winter trap line, about a day's journey apart from each other. Those little cabins allow the men to extend their winter trap lines further from the village. They get up one morning, trap all day, and then just before nightfall land at one of those. I realize it doesn't look like much, but after trapping all day at 40 below, one of those is a very warm and welcome sight. Anybody from the village was welcome to use the line cabin. It's quite simple and very respected rule. If you use something, you have to replace it. So once the men came home to their trap line, they did need a place to put everything that they got. So they had built structures like this one that I'm sitting on. This is called a cache. Cache is a French word for storage. It's built up on the stilts to keep all of our food and supplies up off the ground, out of the winter snow, but more importantly, away from the pesky animals. Talking about pesky animals, on the front of the cache, you can see the smaller fur-bearing animals of the interior. I would like to share them with you. And this first one here is a timber wolf. Yeah, you can probably tell, timber wolves get quite large here in Alaska. This guy is 7 feet from the tip of his nose to the tip of his tail. The Athabascans would actually take cross sections of the back and use it on the outermost part of the winter park rug, known as the sunshine rug, we showed you at the last stop. Here's the wolverine. The wolverine is a very ferocious and cunning animal. The Athabascan people actually refer to the wolverine as Doyon. Can everyone say Doyon? Doyon means chief in Athabascan. They call him this because they believe he's chief of the forest. My grandpa has actually told me stories that if a wolverine and a bear cross paths, it's going to be the bear that steps aside for the wolverine to pass. The wolverine, like I said at our last stop, does have a natural oil in its fur that your breath won't breathe onto, so we put it right next to our face to help prevent frostbite. This next guy is the lynx. The lynx is the cousin of the bobcat. It does have some differences, however, and those include its short, stubby tail, its pointed, tufted ears. It also has these big paws. The paws expand, and they act as snowshoes to help the lynx climb across the winter snow. They're very, very closely related, and they're very common here in the interior. And we also have the Arctic fox. He camouflages to be white in the winter time, and these are usually found above the Arctic Circle. And here are the ermines. These are my favorite. Right now, they're in their white winter coat. In the summer, they camouflage to a chocolatey brown color, and we just call them weasels. But we do have a third and playful nickname for these guys. Would you like to hear it? Okay, well, welcome to the girl, they would cut it up and learn how to sew on it. However, after contact with the outside world, this was taken away from the young girl. It was actually nicknamed the money pelt. Here's the marten. The marten makes a great winter hat. He always uses three. You put one over each ear and then one down the top of your head. Our moms and grandmas always leave the tails off the decoration. My grandma used to say that the tails have a meaning. She said you need one tail on your hat if you're single, two tails on your hat if you're married, and three tails if you're married but you wish you were single. Here's the muskrat. The muskrat is very warm and turns very dead. The seeds are used to make the main body of a winter parka. Make one full-size men's parka, like what we saw in our last stop. This one, it would actually be 40 of these little guys. And this last belt I have to share with you is the beaver. The beaver has two coats. It has a soft, dense undercoat, and then a long, coarse overcoat. Beaver meat is considered a delicacy in Alaska. Does anybody know what it tastes like? I don't know. And that's just so that our pot latches, we always let our elders go first. So by the time I'm in line, there's none left. Come back in about 50 years, and I'd love to share some with you. But right now, I am going to move us on to our last stop. We're going to get a better look at the reindeer, and I'll teach you how the Athabasca people survived thousands of years ago before any contact with the outside world. Go ahead and follow me right up this path.